there.
Oi, oi, come on. Get your bus out.
Oh, all right.
Yeah, we're going to.
Fifty years ago, Boxing Day, 1973, Stan Butler and company would return to the big screen for what would turn out to be the third and final instalment of the On the Bussy spin-off films.
And after five decades, is still bringing generations of families together. And its popularity has never dwindled. And as for the holiday camp, Pontins Prestatyn Sands, where the majority of the film was shot, the place became a mecca for all huge Holiday on the Buses fans,
who made the pilgrimage back year after year to walk the hallowed ground that this phenomenal cast and crew trod during the summer of 73.
And movie giants Hammer left an everlasting footprint on this beautiful North Wales seaside town.
The film came about, basically, they had already made three, the first film had come out being a big success. So obviously then they signed up for a two film package, which is if you watch Mutiny on the Buses, you see the film with one of the buses has a poster on the side saying Go Pontinental on it. So obviously they already knew, they already had in mind the Pontins association with the third film before even Mutiny on the Buses had aired. So obviously they signed up for a two film package, Holiday on the Buses, that the Pontins were looking to promote the new holiday camp at Prestatyn. So it was like viable for both parties. Hammer were looking for somewhere to film at, and Pontins wanted to promote the new film. So it's why they ended up filming at Pontins Prestatyn Sands.
I can remember driving up in a little car, and I had my outfit all ready to put on in the car because it was the same outfit that I used to use for all the jobs that I went for playing the tart with the heart. It had my gossard bra, a low neck top, a lovely choker with a big feather, and a little piece on my head for my hairpiece. And I can remember pulling up and saying, oh, I've not got much time, come on, Mum, where's the tart? Where's the tart outfit? So she dragged it out the back and I quickly put it on. And she said, oh, yeah, that's it, because that's the what used to get me all the jobs. And I was sure it was the feather and the hairpiece. Anyway, I went in for this audition and the two Ronnies were there, Wolf and Chesney, whom I'd met before, and Reg Varney. And I had this audition. Really, it was just a friendly chat. And I thought, okay, I went home. And excited, before I'd got home, I'd had a message to say I'd got the job. So that was wonderful. So that was my first introduction into Holiday on the Buses, which led to the film, which was wonderful. It was 10 days away in Prestatyn at a beautiful hotel on the beach, with people that I knew, Kate Williams and Queenie Watts, Arthur Mallard, who I've just done a series with. And it was a fantastic experience all round. Reg Varney was very good, very helpful to me. I hadn't done a lot of film work, but Reg was always there to make sure that I was in the camera at the right angle and that I was in my light for the shot. You learn on the job. And he certainly did teach me a few tricks of how to sort of work in front of the camera. Yeah, it was a wonderful experience and I loved it. A friend of mine from Joan Littlewood at Stratford was Valerie Walsh. She went on to do, I think, a series with Arthur and Queenie called, was it Yes, My Dear? That's it, Yes, My Dear. Fortunately, she didn't get the job. I did. But we were great mates, and she went on to do a lovely series with Queenie and Arthur anyway for them. So that was good. So we were all mates together. You know, we all end up going to the interviews. We're all sitting there saying, oh, it's your turn today, sweetie. No, I reckon it's yours, Val. No, I've got the last one. And it was great fun. It was our interviews and things, because we were all like a family. And it was very sort of very pleasant, very nice. Very nice times to be in and wonderful experiences. I loved it all.
I don't really remember the audition per se. I'm 4 years old at the time, so I got dragged around quite a lot of different auditions, and you never really know what you're auditioning for. So my real earliest recollection of the film itself was pretty much turning up on set. At that age, when you get taken on to auditions in those days, aren't not what have you done, because you haven't done very much. So they will just basically talk to you and see how you get on and ask you to repeat something relatively within your repertoire range to do, and then you just do what you do, and if they like it, then maybe you get through to the next stage. And I don't remember there being a first stage, so maybe I even went for two auditions. I don't know. I can't remember. I mean, it was summertime, so the weather was quite good and quite lucky. My recollection is, overall, it was about 3 weeks. I might not have been there permanently for 3 weeks, and I do remember going in for about maybe 2 weeks, and then coming away, and then going back again. I do remember we had two different chaperones, so there must have been at least two different blocks with it in Prestatic. I do remember catching the train on one occasion. That was one of them, and I think one of the chaperones had her own car, so I think we drove up on one occasion as well. But all car journeys for a four-year-old are unbelievably long, but actually they could be anything from 2 hours to 6 hours, and it didn't make any difference. But I do remember catching the train there, going via the train station and the pub by the train station and the walkover. I do remember using that one day. I think we had a taxi waiting for us. I think there was, and I say taxi, it could have easily been one of the assistant directors or somebody with a car. Came and picked us up and then took us to the hotel.
Sandra Bryant also travelled to Prestatyn by train to shoot her relatively quick scenes inside the main building at the reception area before a short break, and then heading back to London to prepare for the internal chalet scenes at Elstree Studios.
We stayed on the hotel overlooking the beach. That was very nice. It's got a lovely pool, I remember. Very nice environment, actually, and it was a 5-minute walk into the pontins itself, and that's lovely. First time we were there with the chaperone Emma Tandy, we were in a sort of one big room, sort of one family room, and then there was a little room for me so that she could look after me, of course, and four, so you still need to be looked after. I don't remember my parents ever turning up for the production, so I got palmed off to Emma Tandy. Was the main chaperone, a lovely woman, looked after me really well. I can't say any more than that. And I don't think she was much older than I mean, she must have been about 18 or 19 at the time. So.
Donna Sale had a home at Bargoed, so when they were filming Holiday on the Buses up there, she didn't need any accommodation, i.e. at the, which is now the Beaches Hotel. She didn't need to stay there. She stayed at her family home in Bargoed. I do believe they had a party or something there as well, with members of the cast.
Obviously, it takes, with all productions, it takes a relatively, way longer than you'd expect to set up a camera and the lighting and make sure it all works. And generally, there's a run-through, or at least a point for the focus pullers to get the right focus on cameras of those days. So you had to have a fairly good idea where everything was going to stop and marks on the ground so that people could hit the right spot. So it always takes a long time. So then you do get literally stand around the corner, because you can't leave a 4 year old in a car, sidecar, for 45 minutes. It just doesn't happen. It all gets set up, you get popped in, you come around the corner, it's done in, I think it was done in one shot, and then off you go again for the next one, and then you get taken out, and then they have a quick look at it, make sure it hopefully has worked okay, and then it's fine.
So I turned up for the scene, the boat scene. I didn't know what was going to go on. And I thought, what's going to happen? There I am on a boat. I turned up at Elf Street. Anyway, I just all got changed, went into, got costumed up and went in on the boat. And then it was great. There was guys at one end, guys at the other end. I was on the boat and they were rocking it. And it was fabulous. And rock it one way down, I'd go, are we rocking too hard? No, that's just fine. You know, keep rocking. And that's how the scene was shot. I was most amazed because when I saw it come out, it really did look like I was on in a boat in the sea. But I wasn't. I was in the studio being rocked by these lovely men. I really enjoyed them, especially the lion. Oh, on my last day as well. You know, I do love the motion of a ship. I really enjoyed it. But it was all done afterwards. It's after they'd done this, after we'd shot the film, you know, a couple of weeks after, down I go to do the boat scene. Yeah, it was great. Wonderful.
Walter Hoses and giant fans completed the special effects.
When we were at Prestatyn Holiday Camp, everyone was sort of like with their partners or their boyfriends, but I was sort of like on my own there, and I used to go out with all the fellas. It was wonderful. There was Wilfred Bramble, Henry McGee, Arthur Mallard. I used to go out with those guys every night, and it was great fun. I used to love it. We'd all sort of go out for a drink and come back roaring with laughter. Eunice Black, I had never met before, but I can remember she was in the next room to me in the hotel room. We just sort of met. Oh, you're my mum. Oh yeah, you're Mavis. Yeah, and she was a lovely, warm-hearted lady, and we got on very, very well. It was lovely, and her big line was, "Mavis, bring me thy tail." And she said this big booming voice, like a sergeant major. But she was really, really very kind, very friendly and loving. It was lovely. I loved working with her. I think everybody brought something to the table to make the film valuable, which was a feeling of family. We were all one family. And that is really nice to an actress or an act, anybody who's working in anything, because you all feel equal, like you're in equal partnerships with people. There was no sort of star person or anybody who wasn't as good. We were all just one and we enjoyed it. It was just a great, fun, friendly family time to have. And all the cast were wonderful.
The holiday camp manager, Ray Price, seen here introducing Blakey to the audience, had some very good friends living up in the hills. He inquired if he could bring some of the film crew up to have a look at the house. The crew turned out to be managing director of Hammer Films, Michael Carreras, and director, Brian Izzard. They took an immediate liking to the house, and so it was agreed that the manager's house scenes would be filmed there. The crew arrived on Sunday the 6th of May, turning up in their numbers at 6 a.m. every morning for 4 days. The back door was replaced by one with a very big cat flap, allowing the Alsatian and Reg Viney's double to become stuck in it. Unfortunately, they ran out of time allocated for the filming and had to shoot the bedroom scene back at Elstree Studios, meaning all but one scene was shot entirely on location here in the house. Travelling the furthest for this film was the Alsatian, brought up especially from Devon from an actor's farm. And on Friday the 11th of May, back at the holiday camp, Reg was interviewed by HTV's Mike McAvoy. Mike states that upon hearing the film was being shot at the holiday camp, he turned up unannounced with a small three-man film crew in the optimistic hope of getting an off-chance chatty interview with someone famous for that evening's programme. And he was absolutely delighted to have the opportunity to speak to the star of the show.
Well, they filmed predominantly around the holiday camp, obviously. You had the butler chalet scene, the external butler chalet scenes. The boat and lake, obviously changed now, was a go-kart track in the later years. Obviously the main camp, the ballroom, such like the bar area, reception area, out on the road. They actually filmed in Deserf at the waterfall shops. Apologies if I pronounced that wrong. You've also got Ludlam Bridge, where they lost other cases. Many people mistake for being filmed at the holiday camp as well, obviously, such as Blakey getting towed by the donkey, which obviously was filmed back in Elstree, back at Elstree Studios on the back lot, where the Bovenwood Tesco extra car park is now. That was all filmed there. Same with where Oliver's walking along the corridor. That was the actual admin block at Elstree Studios. And the scene when they're pushing the motorbike when you think it's broken down close to the holiday camp, that was actually in Barnet Lane and South Bolingwood.
Of all the filming locations throughout the movie, the one that has remained the most popular and is still relatively unchanged to this day is the swimming pool. And it was also one of the most famous scenes from the movie. One of the stars of the show and the biggest names at the time, Anna Karen, of course, would not be bearing all. A body double was brought in and paid a fee of £5.
The bus on the beach, a lot of people mistakenly think that the bus perished in the sea, which it didn't at all. That was just our plywood prop bus. We know that from Stephen Lewis actually stating that they had to contact the authorities, the shipping authorities, when the bus actually toppled over and ended up floating out to sea.
We went down, we'd had breakfast, and the chaperone, we sort of had it look over the edge and, okay, how the hell are they going to get that out? And that, I do remember that. I don't remember, obviously most productions have like rigger guys or the guys who make things happen, the guys who put down track or the whatever they do. Obviously I do know what they do, but the point is there's always few floating people around who try and make the production work. And I do remember them, I won't quite remember scratching the heads, but it was sort of that level of how the heck are we going to get that off the beach? And yes, they do. And I do remember it. I don't remember seeing it, but I do remember the rumour that it floated off. I do hear this. So I wasn't there. I didn't see that one that day.
The later scenes when you see the bus looks like it's up to the upper deck and water, that was just a matte painting on a panel of glass. That would have been done by Les Bowie, who was a special effects man, obviously went on to be in, do special effects on Hollywood films like Superman. The bus remained in service until the early 1980s, before it was eventually scrapped.
Smile! Oh, you call that a smile? Give a nice big smile, like this, look!
When you watch Holiday on the Buses, there's always this myth that's gone around for a while now. I'm sure it was an Amazon review or an IMDb review where somebody says it's even got a cameo from Richard Keelan, which is during the scene when you see the Blakey inspecting his staff, the security staff. You see one man who's, he's got a little bit of a resemblance to Richard Keel, but you can see by his height he's slightly shorter than Stephen Lewis. Anyone that knows Richard Keel, he was 7 feet plus, so he would have towered over Stephen Lewis. So it's obviously not Richard Keel. Richard Keel was a Hollywood actor. He certainly wasn't going to come over to do a 10-second Gun and Gap cameo for Peanuts, which is what Hammer would have paid for such a role, so definitely not Richard Keel.
The gentleman in question was in fact a barman and an entertainer at Pontins.
So the scene where we see Michael Robbins, Arthur and Anna Karen going into the water to retrieve the cases at Rutland Bridge, they were both hesitant about that because anybody that's been there will see that it's really quite a mucky stretch of water. Blinders had insisted that they'd done it without a stunt double, so they insisted that they actually had tetanus jabs and all of that before they actually done the scene.
I do remember being in the motorbike, and I do remember the crush on it, and my nan in the film, she was lovely. She made made the whole thing an enjoyable experience. And obviously, I quite like Mobile Legs. I think we all do. To be brutally fair. So I do remember, I don't remember being in the motorbike for a prolonged period of time, and I don't think any of us would be comfortable riding around for hours on that particular motorbike and sidecar. But it was lovely, it was a nice experience, and the bike itself was a classic, of course. Just its age would have made it brilliant. I do remember the bridge and them throwing in the suitcases and all the other the catch-up shots that make the whole thing work. And of course, if you watch it, I think that if you notice that, I think the suitcases float, which is a clue that they're not really heavy. And I do remember when we were loading the suitcases in London, and it was a warm, sunny day, and I'm 4 years old, so I obviously get the "I'm thirsty" comment comes out. And I remember one of the prop guys opens up the suitcase and there's a bottle of Coke. And the weight was Coke bottles. I do remember that. I do remember the break, the action, the reset. And then the props guys throwing suitcases into to make it look like a crash. I do remember that particular part of it. I think originally there was supposed to be us climbing out of the river. I think that was part of the original scene. I don't think it worked. I don't think she was going to be capable of clambering up that bridge. Nobody would, certainly not at her age, unless they were SAS. I guess they'd probably be okay, but not her. So I think that was the original plan, but actually that didn't take place. So they again, cuts in a redesign in production. So
at the start of the film, when you see the buses having the crash outside the depot was actually Old Sound Stage 5 at Elstree Studios, which was demolished in the mid-1980s. Anyone who's been to Pontins before will know how small the chalets are, so it's just totally impractical to think that they've managed to film inside one of those chalets with all of the cast. At times there was four or five cast members in there, plus there would need to be sound man, cameraman, producer, clapperboard operator, lighting and all of that. It's just not feasible. Plus as well, the damage that they'd done to a chalet, it wasn't the sort of thing that Pontins would have accepted. So that's how you know that it wasn't filmed there at all and back at the chalets.
On a wall! On a wall! On a wall!
You can't walk! When you watch the film, if you're familiar with TV studios, because obviously there's two TV studios, one where they shoot Big Brother, etc. And the other production where they used to do Holby City, etc., some of the external scenes. Because it's a proper film studio, a lot of the stuff is usable. So the maintenance in the film, Holiday on the Buses, the maintenance department is actually the maintenance department at the TV studio. So they've used real environment to replicate real environment. And that's quite good. And the other comment we were discussing earlier is the donkey scene. We did try that one, and of course the donkey's a donkey. It's not a tractor, it's a donkey. So they tried to have the scene where the donkey pulls the deck chair away and it runs. But obviously the donkey goes, "Oh," and it's a donkey, it's not stupid. It goes, "I'm not doing that, can't manage that." So after that, we had four or five rigger types on a long rope, holding the rope, got the cue, and then they are towing the donkey as well as the deck chair. So everyone is going, it looks like the donkey's pulling, but the reality is it's five or six rigger blokes who are big, sturdy, and a long rope, and they make the scene work, because the donkey's never going to do that. And you wouldn't be able to expect a donkey to do that more than once, if at all. And it couldn't do it at all. So another trick of the camera. The donkey didn't really do very much other than get dragged around for two shots. And I do remember it did like carrots. There was a lot of feeding that getting the donkey to do with donkey bribery. Here, have a carrot. The gun itself, and obviously it's just a small cat gun, it doesn't make anywhere near the noise. And if you did, the sound guys would go crazy anyway, because it would blow up their mic. So they automatically put the sound effect on after for that kind of thing.
One fact that should never be overlooked is the phenomenal crew that was working behind the camera.
A group that would progress on to forge remarkable careers.
Roy Button, the third assistant director, went on to work on the likes of The Empire Strikes Back, Return of the Jedi, and Indiana Jones and the Temple of Doom. Roy was also a huge influence on Warner Brothers' decision to invest in Leavesden Studios. He's a former executive vice president and director of Warner Brothers production in the United Kingdom.
After his work on Holiday on the Buses, 4 years later, second AD Chris Carreras went on to reunite with Doris Hare and an uncredited Adam Rhodes in Confessions from a Holiday Camp.
He then went on to take his place among the elite, working on four of the Harry Potter movies.
Sound camera operator Chris Munro went on to win two Academy Awards for Best Sound, also working on some unforgettable classics such as A Fish Called Wanda, Muppet Christmas Carol, right up to present day blockbusters on Mission Impossible Dead Reckoning. And credited assistant director Ken Baker continued on in the genre, working on the George and Mildred spin-off movie before branching out to work for some of the biggest names in the movie industry, including George Lucas and Ron Howard on the likes of Willow and Labyrinth.
That was relatively quite straightforward and quite quick. I think we had a couple of goes at it, and that was because I take full responsibility. Initially, we discussed what we were going to do, but then I crept out a little bit too close to Reg, and then, that doesn't work from the camera angles. So we did have to redo it again, and I got a more fixed point aim at stop here if you can, so that the camera angles work much nicer. So that was, and I think we did it in two, possibly three takes. The one I do remember, as I've maybe mentioned before, when the painting and the guns and the water pistols with ink, I do remember that. We set one of them up where we had a glass screen in front of the camera when I was shooting at the camera, and which obviously was a piece of glass to make it look like it's you're shooting at the camera, and that was very good. But obviously the art department came along and helped with the amount of painting I was supposed to have done. It wouldn't take like in hours. I guess that's the whole point of the film. It's obviously it's a proper set, so it's flats and flat screen, flat walls and stuff. I do remember we had the scene where we were supposed to be hit by the branches, etc. And there was supposedly the chaos of being hit by a tree. And I had an ice cream, and obviously of the age where ice creams were definitely a bonus in my life. So they had the one, and they were doing the everyone's getting their own troublesome. And I suggested that how about I do the ice cream, and then they went, yeah, okay, let's have a look, boom. So they, of my very little input to the film as an actor, that was definitely one of them. And I do remember getting another ice cream at the end of it, so it was all very, very positive in my drive. The acting department were allowed to put their input in. Whether we use it or not, that's up to the director and the cameraman to decide. Director, of course. But anyway, they were at least listening to you, which is lovely. And then if they liked it, they could keep it. And if they didn't like it, well, it didn't get kept. It was a couple of days. And I definitely remember two separate days. And I can't remember why it got to a full 2 days. Maybe the weather was bad, I can't really remember. But I do remember going up and down a couple of times. The back to the bus hitting us, that was sort of done in one go. So there was the shot, then the few cutaways to make it all work for the close-ups, which you have to do. And I do remember going up and down, not significant amount. And there was a reason we cut day one. For the life of me, I can't remember, but there was a reason that maybe it started to rain or something. But there was the reason we did a come back tomorrow and have another go.
Sadly, the news that's broken in the last week or two, couple of weeks, and I was down at Prestatyn at the time when it was announced that the holiday camp was going to close permanently. So at the moment, there's a big cloud hanging over that, which is a great shame because We don't really know what's going to happen with the site. It could be flattened and all those filming locations will be lost, which is a great shame. Holds a lot of memories for a lot of people, not just all Holiday on the Buses fans. Obviously, there's a lot of people who do genuinely love going to Ponton's Bedstatton Sands. It's in a really good location there, so that's another reason it would be greatly missed. Obviously, it'd be a big loss for fans being able to visit the filming locations. That would be a big loss, and a lot of the love of going to these filming locations for me personally is to actually walk where a lot of the great scenes were filmed, and stand where Reg, Bob, Anna, Doris, Stephen, and such like all stood and filmed some really iconic scenes, like in the swimming pool right there. To think that they'll be gone is really sad. Hopefully they'll preserve it in some way. Maybe another holiday film will take over the holiday camp, and it will remain in some sort of fashion as it is today. But that remains to be seen. We might find out within the next few months with that. You remember the scene from Holiday on the Buses when you see Stan and Jack walking with the toilet through the camp, and it looks like it's night time, but obviously that was all filmed during the day. They just put a filter over the camera and they make it look like it was night time. The toilet they put in the bushes I do believe were a prop they put there for the filming of that scene. The same system of a filter over the camera to make it look like night time when you see Anna looking for the chalet block, and then she goes her particular chalet, and she goes into the wrong one. That would have been filmed during the day as well. You add the exploding parts of the exploding drains, that would have all just been done very safely. It wouldn't have actually been any danger to anyone of such like. It would just trigger the explosions that you see going through the drains. It would have all been done on a timer, but it wouldn't have been anything majorly bad. It would just been something that would have used to create that effect. The toilet as well, then the toilet blew up. It wasn't actually in the chalet block again. That had been back at the studios, and that was all done.
Oh, I don't think I'll bother with that lot. I'll try elsewhere.
The mystery tour was a big part of the film as well, obviously. They filmed in various locations. That would have been done over a couple of days of filming. You do get the gist of that anyway, because you see the bus heading in one direction up Altigreg, and then it will cut and you'll see the bus heading in the opposite direction down Altigreg. So they filmed on the same road, but the bus heading in a totally different direction, maybe 5 seconds later. You can tell that by the personnel that are on the upper deck of the bus as well. They change from time to time. You can watch the film as well as fun bits when you see, if you look very closely, you do actually see Roy Skeggs in it, who was a executive producer of the film, and a massive part of Hammer's story was Roy Skeggs. He actually saved Hammer from going bust in the late 1970s. You see him in the film in the disco area when they're having the disco. You see him in the background behind Stan and Jack when they're coming into the camp as well.
Walking just a few footsteps ahead of Roy Skeggs, next to Bob Grant, is assistant director Ken Baker.
And the third film, obviously, is the most popular, as I say, with the fans. To me, it's a little bit on the sad side watching it, knowing it was the last time that you've seen the cast all work together on it. It might be even having a little bit more, even sadder now when you're watching it at holiday times. It's always on at Christmas, Boxing Day, around about that time, or the Easter time. You can catch it on somewhere like ITV3. But it'll have that little bit of sadness now as well. If the holiday camp does end up getting flattened, that'll be another added sadness to it. For me, the sadness mainly at the moment is the fact that you watch it knowing it was the last time that they were ever to work together. But in terms of the comedy value of it, it's a great film, obviously, with a really strong backup cast as well, of supporting cast members. Obviously, they brought in Wilfred Bramble from Steptoe and Son. You also had Sandra Bryant, Kate Williams from Love Thy Neighbour, Arthur Mullard and Queenie Watts from Yes My Dear and such like. So it had a very strong cast to it. You also had Henry McGee, who was really popular as well in the 70s with his connection with Benny Hill. A strange little connection there anyway, if you think about it, because Henry McGee was a straight man to Benny Hill, which of course a lot of people don't know that, but way back in the mid to late 1940s, Reg Varley was Benny Hill's straight man. So there's a little connection there between Henry and Reg. But there's no doubt it's most popular of the with the fans of the three films. As well in the film, you had Hal Dyer, who obviously played Mrs. Coombs, holiday camp manager, his wife, who was actually Michael Robbins's wife as well in real life. She actually played a part in one of the episodes as well, The New Nurse. The scene that you see, obviously, with great hilarity in the first aid rooms, you see Cynthia Price, who was an extra that we spoke about before, being in the scene there. And there's also a Scottish man that you see, who was an actor called Alex Munro, who was a massive star on stage in Glasgow, in his native in Scotland, was a big comedy star in the early 1940s, 50s. Obviously, he went on to save Llandudno Theatre, which is just along the road from Prestatyn at the time, which is, I think there's a plaque, if you go to there, I think there's a plaque that mentions that he actually stopped the Llandudno Theatre from closing down, and he was a really iconic figure in that Welsh seaside town. Reg didn't actually do the driving of the buses that we see in the film. That was done by professional drivers. Obviously, the bus that they used was from Crossville Motor Services, and they were adamant their buses had to be driven by a professional driver. Obviously, the bus that was used for the film was still in service, so no damage could be done with that. Problem with Reg was he was totally uninsured bus driver. He could drive the bus, but he was totally uninsured, so they couldn't have an accident on the bus out on the roads with Reg filming. It could be a catastrophic for not just the Hammer Films, but obviously Crossville as well, if they were found to be allowing somebody to drive the bus that was uninsured. So you can tell as well, if you have a look at one of the scenes, is in the holiday camp, which they did, that was one area that they allowed Reg to drive, was as long as it was on the holiday camp. As soon as it got out on the roads, he couldn't do it. If you remember one scene, there's a scene when he gets in the bus and it sort of reverses, rolls back instead of going forward.
Crossville bus driver Harry Steele was also assisted by his dear friend Llewellyn Williams.
Right, when they roll the bus back after being stuck on the beach, they took it back to the depot and it was filthy. And the management said, you wait till the management sees this, they're going to go up the wall. Anyway, what must have happened? A few fellas come down from Hammer Films, like, innit? When we've seen the management, they sort of dropped them a few quid, like, it's a, we'll keep it, you know, what's it like? And he said, oh, don't worry, we'll clean it up and he can have it again tomorrow.
I was around 22, 23 when it first started, and I remember because I worked there in 1972 and we heard, oh, they're filming Holiday on the Buses. So I thought, right, if they have me back, which they did, they said, like, you know, the camp is going to be open and you know, you're still going to get paid, but you can still sort of like go behind the scenes when you're working, if you've got a break or you've got a day off, you can go in and have a look what they're doing. And it was really busy, you know, catered for like the crew that came in. They had a section in the restaurant, you had to serve the campers too, because that was running 24/7. You know, it never stopped. They went out on location a few times, and one afternoon he says to us, one of the managers says to us, oh, they took the hot dog trolley on location, because they put it in the back of a transit van, and this was a big yellow thing. It was really big. And he said, where is it then? He said, it's on the beach there by the Grand Hotel that it was then. So I said, how many are you going to, oh, you go down and get it. So I wandered down there, and I was looking for this hot dog trolley, nothing on the prom. And then he was stuck on the beach. By this time, yeah, the sand had gone, and it embedded itself in, like, and so I had to drag it, and it took me about half an hour to get it off the beach. And I go, all right, rollicking, saying, like, where have you been to all these hours? No, 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 he would want to get this cleaned up, and it's got to go out tonight in the corridor, because they were selling hot dogs there, you know. So I said, well, some bright spark dragged it onto the beach. Oh, I said, never knew that. I said, oh, forget it, you know, forget the telling off. He says, I do apologise and whatever. Desert Falls, they did one there. They also did one up on the mountain. So everywhere the bus went, the hot dog trolley must have gone with them. I think it was my day off, it was. Because you couldn't, some of them were just haytailing out of it. So we're going on the bus when they should have been working, when no one said a word, because they got covered, didn't they? Towards the end, when these two Donny Birds got off the bus, the crowd was unbelievable. There was loads of people around, like, and I thought, I'll try and get in the scene here and just walk past them. And towards the end, there was a guy out of the Rush Lewis Band, I think. He was a big, tall guy, long black hair, wearing a red shirt with a leather jacket over his shoulder, and just walked past then. And as I walked past that way, you know, you could see me perfectly, you know, all in me, what's it, you know, corduroy and all that sort of thing, you know. There.
Although it was her big screen debut, Annette Long was no stranger to show business. At the time, she was a blue coat and all-round entertainer, singing and playing the organ. In the 1980s, Annette released her very own compact disc album. Unfortunately, though, her name was not in the end credits, as she was not a member of Equity. No extra is seen more throughout the film than local lady Cynthia Price, who answered the call when a crew member visited a local church while she was singing with the choir. So impressed with her performances, Cynthia was invited back to Elstree Studios to look into the possibilities of forging a career. She politely declined as her young children were settled in their schools. Another lady who is seen on many occasions was Muriel Ford, who answered the call in the local newspaper and ended up becoming a stand-in for many of the cast members throughout the duration of their stay. At the very end of filming, a football match took place between the Ponting staff and the Hammer crew. The game was kicked off by Doris Hare and Wilfred Bramble.
Oh, this is the football match when we were playing against the film crew. And I think there was a guy called Sex Fuller, could have been. And he was playing left back and I was put on the right wing. And every time I try to run past him, I get clobbered, like, innit? So I said, whatever you do, don't kick the ball to me, kick it over, you know, because every time I try and run with it, like, I can pass it, right, but that's all, I get clobbered, like, innit? So I'm not doing it at all. So anyway, one of my mates played, was playing up front, like, you know, and he says, oh, this is a game of soldiers, this is, oh, go into the, what language you use, like, innit? But it was a bit coarse, like. I said, why is that? He said, there's nine of us here against the film crew, and the blue coats are playing for the film crew. I said, how are they doing that? He said, you know what I mean. So I said, I'll whip back to the kitchen now and see if I can come on second half. So but they said, well, hurry up, it's nearly over. I think they were leading 1-0, I think, the campsite, like, you know. So I got back and he says, oh, come on. He said, just play on the wing and run down that wing, will you? And just cross the ball over to us. And my mate Gareth was playing centre forward at the time, like. And there was a guy who worked with us. I think he worked in the kitchen with us, I'm not sure. But anyway, he was from Abergavenny, South Wales, and he was the goalkeeper. So anyway, I was running down the wing, like, and the goalkeeper, I said, don't pass it to me, they're clobbering me, like, right in the centre, because they were big lads, like, you know. So anyway, he must have kicked it, and they all followed me, and he must have hit it, and it bounced right outside the penalty area. And my mate, Gareth, went up and headed over the keeper that was coming towards him. And that's one of the best goals I've ever seen in my life, I tell you. Jeff Ballison, he come on, and he come on in a suit, took his jacket off, and the ball come right to him. I was waiting for it all the time, trying to score, and the ball just come to him, and he just rolled it into the net, like, and that was the third one. their goalkeeper was wearing the inspector's hat, like. You know, and he was quite a big guy, and he kept the score down because he was diving everywhere, you know, and the hat stayed on. And a couple of days after, then they all said their goodbyes and went. Watching the ballroom scene where they were all sort of like doing the what's it, and when that stopped filming, Reg got on stage when they were sort of having a kind of like a break and started playing away. And he was saying, oh, this is this bit of music, whatever. And it was just, you know, really not soothing stuff, like, you know, and he spoke dead soft and he said, I love playing this. And, you know, because probably like he never got an audience to listen to him. And that place was absolutely packed. When the filming had finished in the daytime, the crew and the guys, the stars and all that, they'd be just like us sitting in the bar drinking, you know. And Henry McGee, you could go up and have a word with him. Oh yes. And he was going, oh well, because Reg never come out much, because I don't think he had ill health then. I wasn't sure, but. He never used, he only just do a bit of filming, then go away then to his room or whatever to have a lie down or whatever, to convalesce on him. But you'd see like all the rest of them out there, you know, you'd given it that, like, you know. And then towards the end of the night, when the bar had closed, well, part of it, and all the entertainment had finished, I know the guy out the arcade be dragging the jukebox through so they could have music. You know, just put off any, what, put a few, you say that anyone changing the records or whatever, then they just go up and put a selection on so they've got music to dance to. We were serving them on the front, you know, on the restaurant part, like, you know, and I said, I can't remember that guy's name, it's a, you know, that big guy. So I'll go and ask him. So he says, excuse me, he says, don't be offended, but I've forgotten your name. And he looked down and he says, it's Arthur. I said, Arthur what? Morod. Oh, thanks a lot. I shook his hand, like, you know, and that was it. So every time he passed, he always give us a wink. You know, that was really good, that was. And another one was, I think it was Wilfred Bramall. He was sitting in the restaurant there, like, you know. And one of the girls says, that's the guy out of Stepton or something, isn't it? I said, yeah, the right guy. You know, why, what do you want? She said, go and ask him for his autograph. Oh, why don't you? I says. So anyway, he says, I said, oh, okay, I'll go. So I says, excuse me, Mr. Bramall. He said, could I have your autograph? And he says, no, he says, they just won't leave me alone. Everywhere I go, he says, they're out pestering me. So I said, well, the only thing I can think of, I says, is if you go upstairs to the Snowdonia bar, it's nice and quiet there. You won't get bothered there at all because it's only open in the evening. The doors are open where you can go and sit and have a, you know, a lounge like, you know. So he said, oh, thank you very much. He said, that's really good. And he gave me his autograph, sincerely, Wilfred Bramall on a bear mat, like, you know, and gave it as I am, and that was it. There was the scene of the line of the security guys. And the camera was going across the building, and there was people looking out through the top of the building, and he says, tell them effing people to get out the window before these shots go off again. One of my mates says to us, he says, no, you're coming out the main reception area with a couple of suitcases. And that wasn't shot in the film. We were doing a scene towards the end, and there was this woman with a daughter, and I said, oh, I'll carry your cases for you upstairs, like, you know. So we went upstairs for these cases, like, you know, in the bus. And what you see, they had a film, they had a camera pointing down the stairs, and all you see, like, is the back of my head getting coming down the stairs, like. That's another one with the blonde hair, like, you know.
Another unused scene that was witnessed being filmed was down at the beach. This would have had Blakey arriving and seeing the bus stranded on the beach and marching across the sand to give Stan and Jack a severe dressing down. In the final cut, however, Blakey had already been fired by the holiday camp before the bus became stranded on the beach.
There was a theatre at the top. Upstairs, and you used to go there, and if they were showing a midnight film, probably a Hammer film, and you'd go and watch that during the season, a different film. So there was a scene where Wilfred and the mum come out of the arcade, and there was an advertising board. And it's tonight's film, The Amiga Man. So we're me and my mates, like, in it, oh, we'll save me about a few scoops. We'll go up there and watch that, like. It was either The Amiga Man 1 week and Twins of Evil the next. So they reversed it, like, you know.
And it was up in that theatre where the cast and extras could watch the daily rushes.
We were taking something down to the old staff canteen down there, and me and my mate said, we'll nip in here and watch them filming. And I think it was just after he dragged Reg through the hatch, the scene after that where the Italian chef said to Blakey, you're the one who's dishonest my sister, and dropped him through the tables, like, innit? Was him falling through the tables, and they weren't sort of like just like props, like in the milk was what they used in the staff canteen, in the kitchen, as well as when they used to pour like the cereals out. It was exactly the same.
Doris, lovely. She. Not my real grandmother, of course, but I felt like she was, she'd looked after me like my real grandmother, and I remember she bought me this bucket and spade for playing in the sand, and that was lovely, and she'd buy me ice creams, and we wouldn't spend much time together, but occasionally you would spend, I don't know, half an hour on scenes, and she would literally I felt like I was being treated like my own grandmother would treat me, and she was lovely. I mean, that's the only words I can describe it. Liked her too, of course. She was, we didn't interact much, mainly because the scenes with her were always interacting with other actors. I'm floating background, really. But she was lovely, she was charming. Do remember being, she was quite funny when she was discussing and chatting to the rest of the cast. The laughter was quite a regular occurrence, I do remember that one.
This is our last chance to have a little rock and roll. Oh, that's a great idea.
But I think we ought to go to the dance first.
Oh, Bert.
Again, I didn't really interact much with him because he was supposed to be the grumpy dad. But actually, again, he was quite funny. When not working, I do remember he was smiling quite a lot. So he was one of those personalities who the interactions around him was warm. I mean, it was just everyone liked him. I found him very charming. He also, we've discussed earlier that actually I got invited on to his show afterwards, which is very good of him. And I don't remember it ever being seen. I don't remember seeing it myself. And obviously my parents didn't record it, I guess. But again, he was quite a charming. I mean, the people, again, he sort of brought warmth out in people, which is a skill I personally don't have, but it was lovely to watch him bring people out of themselves. Actually, there was one scene I do remember where Grandma's there and the thing, it's all getting chaos and hell is breaking loose, and all I do remember is at one point I get dragged sideways by, you know, it's like, but it added to the, I didn't know what was coming, of course. I didn't get I got the full script. I learned what minimal lines I had, and you just do what you're supposed to do. But I do remember being a couple of times sort of almost coming off my feet, being, "Hey, what's going on here?" Oh, and obviously there wasn't much acting going on. That was a real surprise in my face because I didn't know what was happening. Those scenes, obviously, they're set up in way well in advance. You get your basic instructions on what to do, and from my perspective, it wasn't chaos at all. It was nicely choreographed, and I knew what I was expected to do. There was a lot of me damaging stuff. Of course, that's sort of the plot line for a lot of the film, of it's broken and we need a free holiday, etc., etc. From my side, it was very well organised and very well coordinated. But, of course, it does look like chaos, and that's sort of what they're aiming for, of course.
In the original final draft of the script, pre-Stephen Lewis injury, it included a scene which would have had Arthur, Olive and Little Arthur at the play park on the holiday camp, with Little Arthur refusing to go onto the slide unless his mum went on first.
I do remember a scene where it just didn't work on camera. The slide just didn't work. And I remember the cameraman looking at it going, "Oh, let's try that again. No, it's not working. We'll have to scrub that and come up with some other idea." I think it was something along the lines of, so obviously the director and the main cameraman discuss whether they like it, whether they don't like it. That, from having done a reasonable number of years with television afterwards and film, there was a lot of, I won't say ad-libbing, but the script had a life of its own. So if something didn't work, there would be and I won't say a rewrite, but there would be a let's think about that one again, see if we can come up with something else that makes the scene work. And obviously that's, even now that happens with all productions, there will be a few days afterwards where you have cutaways and things that need to be reshot to make things function, because it doesn't always work first time, of course.
One person who benefited greatly from these enforced changes is Wilfred Bramble. Here in the original, Bert is nowhere to be seen within the dance setup. Instead, it's Blakey and Mum who team up. There were pros and cons to these changes for Wilfred Bramble. Cast and extras recall seeing him on the top deck of the Mystery Tour.
I think there was a short, I think it was a go upstairs, some form of discussion. I was not really listening because I had an ice cream, and that was definitely my high spot of the day. And then he came back down again, and that was it. I don't remember him being shot or cut or spoken.
Another intriguing scene would have had the bus coming to a halt in the hills and the passengers alighting to vent their anger.
I do remember getting off the bus, and I didn't budge from my upper deck seat, and I do remember there was an attempt at it, and I think the director, there wasn't enough people to make it the chaos scene that they wanted, and you couldn't get a one or two people in a run would not make it, so you need 30 people at a mass, and there's no way you can actually do that in reality because it just doesn't work. I remember the ice cream van, because I think I've mentioned, I might have touched on the fact I like ice cream. I do remember, I remember the cameraman, the guy who took the photograph, and I think from memory, he had one of those, I digress. You know, quite a lot of the cameramen have a camera in a box, so when it goes click, you can't hear it on sound. And I do remember he was fiddling with that, and then I do remember him taking the photograph. I do remember that the camera crew were absolutely lovely, actually. They were, and as a four-year-old, they treated me really well. If I asked a technical question, they would answer a technical question. They always seemed to have enough time to talk to me. And I never got fobbed off as a go-away stupid child. It was always... they were excellent. The sound guys by general definition, are generally quite, I won't say aloof, but they were always slightly further back with a man with a pole, and you never really interacted with those. But they were very quite fun as well. I do remember there was always standing gags, and people were having messing with each other gently, but it was always in a good humour, and it was always very, very funny. I do remember even all the way down to the film extras, the people who were there, they were lovely, and quite often, because you're four, quite often some of them would come and talk to you and get you an ice cream, or they would just show you something, or just everyone, from my perspective, filled a four-year-old day up really nicely, and the whole thing was a joy to be involved in, actually. Everyone was nice, production crew, directors, sound guys, lighting guys. I don't really remember talking to them much, because maybe they're sweating because they're trying to put a couple of redheads up and don't get the whole thing lit properly. Everything else sort of was actually charming. There was a little bit of chaos because it was a filming in production, so it was always, that doesn't work, let's try this worked better, okay, maybe we can try it again. They didn't do very many retakes, so it was sort of an as live feel, and that sort of adds something to the production as well, of course. I mean, it keeps the budget down, but it also means it gets through at a relatively good pace. I do remember the comeback function, and that one, I do remember. It was keep it rolling, bigger, big as you can go. So I do remember getting direct instruction on, because you can make, you know, come back, no, as big as you can get it. Ah, no, that's too much, you know, that kind of, however, it was, I don't know, 30 seconds of keep the camera rolling and just keep going until you get something that they can cut one of those, and that would be good enough. So when we did shoot the inside the chalet scenes, it was a proper studio setup. We did try at the holiday camp itself, but the size of the rooms in those days, cameras nowadays are much, much smaller and are really quite minuscule compared to what they were 50 odd years ago. So a camera, you might be able to get something in, you might get it through a window. And obviously, in studios, you can control the size of a building. So the studio flat inside the set is enormous. I mean, there is no possible way you would get that as a holiday camp size, because it would be a palatial... it would cost you way more than most people would have paid for a normal holiday if you had a room that size. But it was definitely a studio. It was flats. So when they painted it all up, and, you know, you have the standard props and the flat weights, the studio, the stage weights holding them up. That house was definitely not it, but I do remember being inside a actual building that wasn't a studio. And I can't tell you where, but I do have a recollection of a house, garden, path, hallway, kitchen area, but it was quite boutique, is the phrase I use, small. But I do remember a studio, and it, probably the first one just didn't work, because again, it was too with cameras of those days, you need a reasonable amount of space to move them around. Quite often, when you build a building that is, you know, the series of flats, quite often you can take out half a wall, and they have sections specifically designed so the camera can have a shot through the window and make it look. So obviously, in the real world, you would never be able to get a camera there, but it's not the real world, of course. Reference Queenie Watts and Arthur Mullard. I never remember actually doing a proper scene with them, but I do remember they were quite often enjoying the sun. The weather was lovely outside. The two of them were, when you would walk past them on the way to the main Pontins building, etc. Again, you could basically, all you could hear them was them two laughing. The two of them were just enjoying the day. And again, they would always, for me, a four-year-old, they were always very pleasant and would interact with you, at least hello and how are you doing and that kind. It was very, they were charming. And I do remember that you could see them from the hotel. As you looked into the compound, you could actually generally see them. They were sitting on their deck chairs enjoying themselves.
Wally and Lil already existed in the Wolf and Chesney universe. The pilot episode of Romany Jones had aired in 1972, and Series 1 was eventually broadcast on the 8th of June 1973. Mr. and Mrs. Briggs deciding to take a not-so-well-earned break away from their normal habitat, a caravan, and exchanging it for a chalet on a holiday camp.
I do remember there was quite a lot of rain, but the weather was generally quite nice, and I do remember, having gone back 4 years ago, I do remember thinking, last time I was here, which was 45 years before, at the bottom of this, there was a puddle. Oh, it's still there. So there was a recollection of coming down the stairs, at the bottom of the stairs. When I was a kid, I always had to remember, you had to go to the left because that was the dry route through the, off the steps. And 45 years later, go down the stairs, the puddle is still there. I mean, obviously it must be a different set of water, but it's definitely the same puddle, and they'd never really quite sorted out the pavement. Still there, 50 odd years later, the puddle has never been fixed. I do remember going to see a preview, and I don't remember where, but I do remember we had a preview, and it must have been in London. I think it must have been in London, because it was about an hour away from West London, where I was living at the time. So it was, we did have a preview. I enjoyed the film. I mean, obviously, most of the adult humour went above my head, and that's fine. But I did enjoy the film. It's amazing how well it's still going, and still people still remember the television series and the films.
We had to go to the Odeon and Rill to watch it. Mainly me went, like, you know. And he said, "Oh, there you are, there." And that one, he said, and when they were filming him, he said, "I was on one of them somewhere." He says he was standing all in his whites in the playground, watching Blakey Chase stand across the water. I mean, you could see him actually, you know.
I do remember going in my paddling. I do remember not swimming in it. It's a lovely location for what it is. Lovely location for UK based holidays. The beaches were nice. The weather's not particularly. It's generally quite warm. Obviously, it's Wales, so you do tend to get a lot of rain. But it was a lovely summer. I mean, I do remember the weather was good. Not much rain. The beaches are certainly acceptable. I do remember eating a lot of ice cream. That was the one way to keep a four-year-old quiet. It was like an ice cream. Oh, yes, please. And I do remember having been bought my bucket and spade. I do remember making good use of that with the plastic flags to go in the corners once you'd made them. I do remember that. I do remember the entrance to the camp with the staircase. It was definitely a big memory of mine, and talking to the director, to the cameraman about different angles and how they were going to shoot it, and his point In fact, my earliest recollection of a light meter, going, oh, we need a light meter, and he's reading the light and he's getting the for the exposure times. And I do remember covering it with my hand, going, it's not showing zero. And he goes, well, that's because you don't block light. And they actually spent time explaining to a four-year-old the intricacies of camera lighting, which is superb. I mean, if you can spend the time with a four-year-old and actually be 100% accurate and get it through, then, you know, they are masters at their job. If you've got that much spare capacity to teach and do it, brilliant. I do remember being envious the first time I see them and the double quad bikes as they were all cycling. And I do remember getting to go on one of them. However, it was a real struggle for me because my legs were nowhere big enough for the... So that wasn't a great success, shall we say. And I think that was the real reason I got my bucket and spade. I think there was the disappointment, oh, never mind, let's go and get you a bucket and spade, that'll make up for the loss of the cycling around. In one word, enjoyable. If I could recommend that to everyone, it was a superb childhood memory of a very nice holiday camp location, and the weather was lovely, the beaches were nice, the people were excellent. Food was sort of canteen standard, but as a four-year-old, guess what? I was okay with that. So for me, I do remember the people enjoying themselves, and there was quite a lot of laughter, and people were definitely enjoying it in those days. Absolutely no problems at all. I did go in there a couple of times because the filming is obviously not done at 3 o'clock in the morning or whatever. It's always done at reasonable time and close the curtains and make sure that it looks darker. I do remember it was a standard production. There was no... it was nice. And as you know, that space upstairs is enormous. The ballroom is enormous. I mean, it really is what it is. It's a big ballroom. The extras, etc., they sort of enjoyed themselves there as well. I mean, the feeling was sort of a family group type production, as opposed to, it wasn't sterile by anyone's imagination. It wasn't, right, we're going to do this and it has to be that. It was, we've done that. It didn't quite work as well as we'd hoped. We will do a quite slight rewrite. This is how it works. And we will just make it work. And it's sort of how it all works. That was all supplied by my mum. So I don't remember, I mean, to be fair, 4 years old, clothes that appear and disappear, I have no actual input onto any of it. I don't remember them being supplied by the costume department. However, maybe the jacket, because the jacket would definitely, you'd need probably a couple of those, because it's easy to rip one and you really need a continuity coat just in case. I do remember that she was very smiley, and that sort of the filming was actually very pleasant. It all worked really nicely, and if you watch the film, you can see a lot of work in a lot of theatre production. So he's moving around, holding shot to the camera like he's on a stage, and I do remember that one to be all charming. But he can't turn around because the rest of the set doesn't exist, so there's no way you're getting a wide shot on him.
Phil Mishu and colleague Bob Hewitt were photographers during the time of filming. Phil shares a memory of a very famous photograph.
I was working as a freelance photographer for the Daily Post during the filming of Holiday on the Buses at Pontins. And the newspaper asked me to pop down there and see what I can get as a couple of still pictures for use in the paper. Well, when I arrived, they were actually in the middle of shooting one of the canteen scenes. So obviously you have to hang about a bit, wait until they take a break. And then I approached the director and asked him if I could do a couple of shots, you know. And he said, oh, yes, yeah, that's fine, no problem. He introduced me to Reg Varney and Stephen Lewis, who were both there. Stephen was sitting down at a table with his leg propped up, and Reg, with a big grin on his face, as usual, said, "What sort of picture shall we do for you?" I said, "Well, anything a bit offbeat, you know, do a bit of funny business." And he said, "Oh, right, great, that sounds OK." So he had a look around, he quickly looked around the set, and he saw some workmen had left some tools over in the corner. And he grabbed this saw. He said, "I know what we'll do. We'll cut Blakey's leg off." And everyone howled with laughter. And that's exactly how it happened. I've never met two nicer guys. They really were up for anything. And Reg said afterwards, he says, "Will that be all right for you?" I said, "Yes, that's perfect. Just what I want." And as it happens, the film crew had left the lights on for us, so I didn't need any flash, and it just turned out perfectly. And I was very pleased with the shot.
Although he had no involvement in the scenes in the manager's house, Bob Grant came along to watch his friend film some scenes. And Bob Hewitt speaks of a chance encounter with Bob Grant up in the Prestatyn Hills.
On the day in question, when he was walking up Guynuska Hill, it was a hot day, you know, when we used to get nice summers around here. And, of course, we knew each other face to face because I'd been photographing him and Reg down at the holiday camp. I mean, I've driven it hundreds of times, but it's all first and second gear. It really is a steep hill. I was in the car, but on the lower section. So I pulled over and said, "Hi, mate, are you OK? Where are you off, you know?" And he was sort of wiping his brow, and I wouldn't say he was sweating profusely, but I think he was certainly, you know, feeling the strain of going up that huge hillside at the back of Prestatyn. And we chatted for a couple of minutes, you know, and but his... his words were, as he was wiping the sweat from his brow, "I hope there's a pub up here somewhere, mate." And that's when I said, "Well, yeah, if you carry on going, there's a pub called the Eagle and Child up in the village." And I assume that, you know, he made it all the way up and enjoyed a nice cold beer. And if you've tried walking it yourself, you'll know that certainly on a hot day, you certainly do need a pint or something when you get to the top.
Bob and Phil also had their on-screen debut, captured on camera here on the left-hand side, walking across the forecourt to the main building in Pontins Prestatyn. Whatever the future holds for this holiday camp and the filming locations that lie within, one thing is absolutely certain. We can revisit, in all its beautiful original glory, again. And again. And again.
There was one experience which was very special to me. I finished a Linda LaPlante, She's Out, Carlton television series, and the girl who played in the series with me, Zoe Hayes, a lovely actress, she came home and we had, actually it was Christmas, and we had Christmas dinner and things, and I said, "I'm going to play you Holiday on the Buses, Zoe." And she said, "Oh, okay." So I played the film and I was watching it and we were laughing, and all of a sudden she was bursting into tears and were crying. I said, "What's the matter?" And she said, "Oh, that's my dad." I said, "What do you mean that's your dad?" Well, apparently they'd filmed her father in Prestatyn. He'd gone to Prestatyn at Pontins for his holiday, and they'd filmed him dancing in the big ballroom, and she didn't know this. And then he'd died and passed on, and she was with me at Christmas, and she saw her lovely dad, very happy, dancing in Prestatyn in the ballroom. It was a wonderful moment.